Welcome to CSIS Online. The way we bring you events is changing, but we'll still present live analysis and award-winning digital media from our Dracopolis Ideas Lab, all on your time, live or on demand. This is CSIS Online.
Thank you for taking the time to join us today. I'm Nilima Jain, Deputy Director with Vadhvani Chair at CSIS. Under the Goods and Services Tax GST regime introduced in July 2017, the Indian states transferred a notable share of their fiscal autonomy to the center in exchange for promised compensation for any shortfall in GST collections. This very premise has been under severe test for the past 2 months. Precarious economic situation and the pandemic has resulted in a shortfall. In the GST Council held in August, states were informed about center's inability to compensate for the loss of GST revenue. Center was of the opinion that states should borrow. States were given two options, either borrow from RBI or from the open market. Only 21 of the 36 states and union territories had agreed to use one of the options. The center state impasse continued in the GST councils that followed. But in a recent change of event, the Ministry of Finance said that the center will borrow. What nuances does this new option entail? What is the best way forward for the states? How does this bode with cooperative federalism and the investor community? To answer these grave questions and more, I have an all-star cast panel with me today. My first panelist is Subhash Chandra Garg, former Economic Affairs and Finance Secretary to the Government of India, a veteran of past GST Council meetings and the most definitive voice on center-state dynamics among several other subjects. Our second panelist is Mukesh Bhutani, founder and managing partner of BMR Legal and a very celebrated lawyer in India, especially in international tax and GST. Finally, my most famous namesake, Nilima Pragankar, who leads the US-India Business Council's Financial Services Committee. Prior to USIBC, Nilima has spent more than 16 years as a regulator in Financial Industry Regulatory Authority, erstwhile NASD. A warm welcome to all of you. It is a real honor to host you and moderate this discussion. So to unpack this issue, Garg sir, let me first turn to you. Central government, who seem to have changed their mind, have offered to borrow 1.1 trillion rupees, about $14 billion, and the amounts of borrowed will be passed on to the states as back-to-back loan. How does this play out on states' books? Per some accounts, the total cumulative market borrowing of 30 states have already increased by 51% between April, September of 2020. What impact will this have on the overall liabilities, and where does this leave the states with the two borrowing options? Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Nilima. It's good that the government of India finally decided to take the right call, that they would borrow and give it to the states. What it means is that in the system of accounting which we follow for some of these kind of special needs, the government would borrow either from the market or from the Reserve Bank. That's not clear at this moment. But whatever it borrows, it will provide most likely on back-to-back terms to the states. And once the loans taken by the central government goes to the states on back-to-back terms, then in some of the cases also, the government of India treats that as a negative or nil addition to the fiscal deficit. It's shown by way of a minus entry. So you have taken loan, you have given loan on the net basis. The government of India taken fiscal deficit remains, puts the government here in that sense that the fiscal deficit doesn't rise. But for the states, it's a borrowing, right? So whether they would have borrowed themselves or they take it from the central government, as far as the states are concerned, on both the fiscal deficit as well as for the loan book, the state's liability go up, right? So that is the way it will be treated. Now, so far, it's not very clear that what will be the final GST shortfall. At this stage, it is estimated that 3 lakh crores minus 65,000, so 2,35,000 crore would be shortfall. At this moment, about 1,10,000 crore is agreed to be borrowed, which is about 0.6% of the GDP. So it will land in these states, and they will, their fiscal deficits and the debt liabilities will go up by 0.6%. The states are already stressed. They also have a problem on other sources of revenue. Their non-GST revenues are suffering. So to that extent, this money comes to them, they will be able to match their cash shortfall to that extent. But neither does it meet the entire cash shortfall, nor does it keep their revenue account healthy. This will inflate their revenue deficit. And ideal way, in my judgment, would have been for the government of India to give it as grant to the states. But at this moment, this seems to be the answer, though some of the dissenting states have not accepted this. And therefore, we will see how this plays out finally. But it seems at this stage, the government of India will deliver the entire amount of shortfall, whether it turns out to be 2 lakh crores, 2,25,000 crores, by way of borrowing to these states. And this state's finances will be impacted to that extent.
So, sir, does the state have any other option? What happens if some of the states choose not to take on this option? I know that Kerala Finance Minister has given a positive remark, but we don't know yet if all the states have agreed or not.
See, the states have absolutely no other option. The borrowings of these states are permitted or required to be approved by the government of India. And therefore, the states cannot borrow on their own. And their ways to raise revenues is limited. Their own current revenues are not what they are able to maximize or even collect as much as what they have budgeted. So they have no option. Finally, they will have to sort of fall in line. Or if they go to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court, which is absolutely unlikely in my judgment, it is ordered that no, the central government will give it a grant, or the central government at some stage has another change of heart, like it has had so far. Earlier they were saying no, states will have to borrow themselves. Then they got the better council prevail on them and decided to borrow themselves. So if that would have been the solution, to my mind, if Mr. Arun Jaitley was in place, he would have offered this as grant to these states. This change may come, may not come, we can't say at this stage.
Sure, sir. Thank you. Mukesh, let me now turn to you. Now, GST Council has had a limited or no success in resolving the federal disputes. This latest option on the table was not the outcome of a council. It was almost a unilateral outcome. What really is the mandate of the GST Council, and how is this evolving? Can you throw some light on that?
So, Nilima, thank you first for inviting me, and it's an honor to be on this panel with all the panelists over here. I think before I answer your question, it's important to understand the framework under which the 101 Constitution Amendment Bill was passed. Essentially, it had been a subject matter of debate because of the manner in which the whole Constitution was written, insofar as of the state and the center is concerned, for certain taxes. So this was a very unique amendment, because for the first time, there was an agreement to share the taxing power. For the first time, there was an agreement to sovereignty, which in my view was a very decisive step forward to promote cooperative federalism. Now, as a result of these, what happened that the state government ceded their autonomy to independently frame the tax policies, because they were fully assured that the center will get compensation. This compensation was specifically mentioned, said that the parliament shall make a law on the recommendation of the GST Council and provide for compensation to the states for loss of revenue arising on account of implementation. Now, this arising on account of implementation has become a subject matter of conflict, if I may use that word. But the powers of the GST Council are unparalleled over here. And the GST Council also has a mechanism that in the event the decision cannot be taken with any form of a consensus in absence of any voting power, then the voting takes place and there is a very clear mechanism laid down for this voting. So I think what seems to have happened over here is that the pooling of sovereignty and the sharing of the power has resulted in the situation that we find ourselves in. But the empowerment of the GST Council with the amendment to the Constitution remains unshakable. It is this particular body that takes the view. Now, there is a mechanism that has been prescribed for dispute resolution. And this dispute resolution has to be done by an authority. And this authority will adjudicate. And we as lawyers means adjudication means that it has a power of a quasi-judicial forum to actually come and arbitrate a dispute. This authority was not set up. And I think it's completely unimaginable that in the situation that the center and the states find themselves in, that this authority can be set up, because the very composition of that authority will result in a dispute. The second aspect I wanted to touch, and I entirely agree with Mr. Garg on the power of the center versus the power of the state for borrowing. So there are two other provisions in the Constitution. One prescribes for the power of the center to borrow, which is unparalleled. And the power of the borrowing would mean that it offers the security of the consolidated funds of India within the limits. Now, these limits are there, prescribed under a law called fiscal responsibility and budget management. But it is the parliament that has the right to amend this law. So in other words, the center has imposed itself a law to lay down the limits of borrowing. However, it has the power to amend the law, which takes away the limits for such borrowing. However, under the Constitution, the state's power to borrow is limited by the restriction that the center imposes. So in other words, states can borrow. There is a constitutional empowerment that, but that borrowing is subject to two conditions. Number one, that it has to give guarantees, and those guarantees are fixed up to the limits prescribed by the center. So let's say, for instance, a pension fund in the United States want to subscribe to a bond, say in Gujarat or Maharashtra, considered as very important states. Now, they cannot simply go and raise the bond issue because the limits for fixing the guarantees is still done by the central government. So there is an empowerment in the Constitution, but again, you have to go to the center. And hence, logically, what Mr. Garg said is correct, that the revised decision seems to suggest that it is the center that will borrow, as compared to the original proposition that the center was telling the states to borrow.
Okay, that makes sense. And we can definitely see that the center is at least taking the steps in the right direction. Okay, Nilima, let me turn to you. The investor business community is keeping a close watch on the GST compensation issue. Now, in addition to the reputational risks, what other implications this evolving situation may have on the business sentiment? Simply put, what is the business community looking for?
Thank you, Nilima, and thank you for allowing me to join this panel. It's truly an honor to be on the same space as Secretary Garg and Mr. Bhutani, truly. So I'd like to thank you for giving me the opportunity. It's a very important question that you ask, because ultimately it is about a reputational risk, but it's about something more. Industry is very carefully watching how these events fold and the ways in which these issues are resolved. And I want to make a distinction. I don't mean to say that they may favor one option over the other or an approach. They may have certain opinions, but industry as a whole, rather they have a stake in the GST framework itself and the smooth and continued operation of that framework. And to understand the depth of this concern, I think we need to take a step back and think through how GST and its potential benefits were embraced by the industry, and then how GST has impacted the way business is done. And if we do that, then we can see why this conflict presents concerns. At its core, I believe GST was an opportunity for growth. for business. And industry understood that, and they embraced the very high expectations. And I want to really just go over just a few ways in which GST has changed how business is done. You know, there was a very clear understanding that the free flowing of credits was going to lead to an overall reduction of prices of goods and services, which in turn could spur demand, and that the barrier-free movement of goods across India would allow companies to more easily meet that demand and create an opportunity for their growth. And the simplified tax rates would contribute to productivity with enhanced tax compliance across the system so that there was greater standardization and formalization of business. Now, what all of that means is that there would be a stable and more predictable tax environment that could serve as the real basis for company strategy for growth and continued expansion and investment in the markets, and ultimately making India a more competitive place. And I don't want to say that implementation has been perfect. It hasn't. There have been challenges, but it has happened. And it has led to concrete changes in the way that companies do business. Service providers and manufacturers started to think about a different way to approach accounting. You know, supply chains have changed. Companies have optimized procurement operations. They've been able to improve inventory management with less transit stays. There's a reduction in lead time, which has allowed for consolidation and greater flexibility. So the implementation of GST, as imperfect as it may have been, has led to genuine changes. Companies have invested resources into building compliance structures to meet the accounting and reporting requirements. They've made changes in supply chains to try and capture some of the opportunities that were there. Having spent these resources, industry as a stakeholder who I think fundamentally want GST to continue in a smooth operation to capture increased potential benefits. We're only in year three. So these structures have just been put in place. Some of the benefits are just starting to be realized. So the compensation issue gets at one of the pillars upon which GST was built, the relationship between the center and the states. And the concern is that that there should be a smooth and orderly resolution of the issue to give industry confidence that the GST framework and its components upon which it was built, the center and state relationship, can and will work together in the future. And that in doing so, that there would remain a stable and structured economy, a tax economy with clear and transparent tax laws. So I'm gonna stop there, but I think that's the concern given the impact of the GST, the way companies have changed businesses, and what it means for their future investment.
It makes sense because, you know, it's not about the options that they choose, but the faith that they have put in the center-state relationship. And the business continue to see that mechanism growing and not really distancing apart. So let me come back to you, Gert, sir, and ask you, what other options could have made more economic sense for the states? I know you briefly mentioned, the latest development could be given as a grant, but is there any other way, option that you see that could have made more economic sense to the state?
The states are fiscally constrained entities, right? They have limited taxation power in our constitution, and much of that taxation power was in the form of the sales tax, which has now got merged into the GST. And therefore, states' independent space for taxation has got further reduced. Much of the resources for the states now come from either transfer of share in central taxes to the states, or by way of GST revenue. if you put these three into context, something close to about 80%, 75% to 80% comes from the central taxes transfer or the GST share. And therefore, expecting states to sort of be independent and raise their own resources is very difficult. The second thing, and this was discussed in the earlier part, the state's borrowing power is also constrained. The states cannot borrow outside the India that is there. And as long as states are sort of indebted to the central government, their borrowing limits have to be approved by the central government, irrespective of wherever you want to borrow. Right. And therefore, states cannot borrow also. Now, if you don't have revenue raising authority and if you don't have borrowing authority, then the state's ability to raise resources is constrained. And therefore, the constitutional design in India is responsibility more by the state powers and the expenditure obligations. That is why the finance commissions have been giving more and more. Last finance commission raised it to 42%, right? But partly that has also been neutralized by sort of raising cesses. So you have now excise duty on petrol and diesel raised to 50%. So, and effectively the share in central taxes to the states is about 31% instead of 42%. So the states have to be sort of supported, the hand has to be held by the central government. And therefore you had this sort of constitutional gentlemanly commitment that we will ensure that for 5 years we'll have the GST. And if there any kind of extra assess will be levied, this can be increased any time you want. So what I would think is that the solutions are two. One, the central government should assume the broader responsibility, should earn the trust of the states and give the entire shortfall without any sort of conditions, hitch or otherwise, for the states to be compensated for the whatever GST shortfall is to the extent of 14%. Second, the central government this year, especially considering the fact that there is a huge constraint on the states, should allow increased borrowing. They allowed, central government allowed states to borrow 5%, up to 5%, but that was made conditional on several things.
Yeah.
This was also clever by half strategy. The states are not your municipalities. States are not that kind of entities where you subject them to so much of conditions. Give them the authority to borrow up to 5% without any question. Right? In the long run, in my judgment, the time has come when the states become independent of the central government as far as the borrowing is concerned. That requires that the states are able to pay their all dues or loans taken from the central government. It used to be very high extent until 2004-05. The state's borrowing used to comprise about 70 to 75% loans from the central government in different forms and about 15% to 20% from the market. That was the composition. It has completely reversed now. The states borrow about 85% of their from the market, and the central loans to the states have reduced over the years. Now you need to take the last step, allow the central loans to be sort of swapped by the market loans and let the states pay out the central government, and then they would become completely free to decide their own borrowings, which would only be subject to their own FRBMs. I think that is the second thing. These opposition states should think of, rather than taking, you see, the another measure which has been done, that 12,000 crore would be provided in the form of that 50-year loan, low interest. This is a trap. If you take it, then you would be trapped for 50 years, bonded to the central government for permission for a small amount. So I think that is the second thing which we should do. See, these are very basic decisions or basic agreements which are done. It's very important not to lose trust of the states. Earlier, if you would remember, in 2005-06, when the states were persuaded to go for the VAT, again on the assurance by the central government that we'll compensate you in case there is a shortfall in your revenue growth. Then again, in 2008, when the global financial crisis had hit, the then government had gone back on its words and had not paid the compensation due in 2007-08 and 2008-09. When the GST deal was being negotiated, the states were completely aghast and they were not agreeable, precisely because at some point of time, there was this kind of reneging on the agreement. Now, the central-state relations and the agenda is not finished. There's so much things to do still. Agriculture reforms, other taxes, and many other things are there. Industrial reforms, labor reforms. These can be done only if you have a trusting relationship between the central government, the center, and the states. And that is very important that you must work. In fact, you should go out extra mile to see that the states feel completely sort of at home, that yes, everything which was promised is being.
Sorry, it froze.
I've stopped.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, sir. Thanks. Thank you for that, comprehensive plan. And I'm just wondering, and I actually, it's a question both to you and Mukesh, what is stopping the center to take any or all of these states?
See, if I can respond and then Mukesh can join. I think there are times, there are two things. One, the approach of the general approach of the government towards the federalism, that is one. And second, I think it makes a lot of difference about the personality and the preferences of the person engaged in the seat as the finance minister. Mr. Jaitley had a totally different. I think if he was not there, the GST agreement would not happen. It was his persuasive abilities and his ability to go two steps further and to accommodate everything. If you look at that kind of debate, everything which the then Congress states and others had asked was provided. And that was only because that large-hearted, because the objective was to get a GST which is good for national economy, what Nilima was referring to, which is good for national business. So much of waste has been reduced on the tolling points and elsewhere, interstate borders and all. And so much of efficiency comes if you have, so much of transparency comes if you have a national GST, one single GST. But the current, I think, if I may say so, the current incumbent does not seem to have that kind of approach. It is a little more of one-upmanship, being a bit smarter than the others, that kind of approach rather than that large-heartedness. And in terms of the federalism also, somehow, and it's reflected in some other context also, if you look at the way the farm laws have been handled and all, that there is a tendency towards converting Indian federalism towards more of a competitive unionism kind of thing, or unionist federalism, more of union than of the federal kind of thing. I think this is what probably informs and guides what it is happening. It should change.
Sure.
Mr. Bhutan.
No, I think I largely echo what Mr. Garg is saying. The answer doesn't lie in the constitution, or the answer doesn't lie in any form of a judicial forum. Even if a resolution forum, I doubt if we would have been able to come to a consensus which would have kept both sides happy. So I think the long-term solution lies in consensus building, and that's where I take the point that Mr. Garg is making. Consensus building is all about personalities. As we say, a disputes lawyer in the court and an arbitration lawyers, both are solution-driven, but both have a very, very different approach altogether. I think that, you know, to me, this situation, even if it comes to a conclusion, it would certainly leave states with some bruises. And I think from a center-state relationship standpoint, that's not healthy. And I'll tell you one important reason why it is not healthy. The GST reforms as they stand today are no different than started off with. So the design of 2017 said that we should start subsuming other forms of levies which currently are levied by the state, particularly the petroleum goods, the electricity tax, and the stamp duty. Yeah. It's ironical that some states, and these were not NDA states prior to the COVID, were supporting the fact that in order to give push to the real estate in those states should actually support center stand to subsume stamp duty, you know, and the transaction cost in some of the states are very, very high. Now, in this environment, you see that form of a consensus not happening, even if states economically behaved that it makes sense for them. Take a case of Maharashtra, which last month has gone ahead and slash the stamp duties. Now, in this environment, for any state to slash the stamp duty is a very, very difficult decision. But they've done that because they recognize that the real estate development and all the sectors that support real estate, like cement, steel, small-time contractors, are also suffering in the COVID period. So I think I consider that as the biggest impediment, and that is an impediment for growth that strikes to the very root of the economy and merely delay the revival of the economy as it comes out of the COVID phase. I think other important aspect over here is the borrowing. As was correctly pointed out, there are inherent limitations. I think a consensus approach can be achieved if central government does not come out with one-size-fits-all approach. Now, we know that there are certain states that have huge economic activity in the agricultural basket. So is there an opportunity to persuade those states to start levying agricultural tax on rich farmers? There are certain states which historically have had with the center on lotteries. For example, the state of Kerala, the northeastern states. Can we do something for that? There are some states that are sitting on land banks. There are some states that are sitting on unprofitable undertaking. Are there opportunities to persuade those states to demonetize by selling the land banks or by divestment of state undertakings? So I think there are many approaches that are workable. Can the center persuade certain states to adopt relaxation in labor law or in the environmental regulations so that you can promote greater degree of industrialization and promote growth? Because growth is the answer for all the solutions. So I think that this impasse that we are seeing now is not just unhealthy from a state-center relationship, but it is also going to dissuade states from undertaking reforms which are well within the ambit of their responsibility from a constitutional frame standpoint.
Very true. Nilima, would you like to add anything from a business lens to this conversation?
Yeah, yes. Both Garg Sir and Mr. Bhutani have mentioned the idea of trust. And I have to echo that because it is the trust between the center and state that becomes reflective of the trust that I think industry can have in the GST Council, the center, and the GST framework itself. It becomes reflective of the way that issues are going to be resolved that impact companies as well. So it's not to say that there is an issue is so surprising. I think that with a framework that is so deep and so vast and so revolutionary in India, there would be bound to be issues. But it is the resolution process, the consultativeness, the transparency that becomes important in terms of even industry getting a sense of how they themselves will be dealt with and addressed going forward. And so I have to echo that it's not about the specific technicalities, but the process by which the states feel that the feeling is that it's been a fair and equitable process. And I think the only thing I would add is that from the industry's perspective, I think there is the fear that what are some consequences of an unfair or inequitable process? What will the states do in turn? Now, it is of course true that they've given up their rights to taxes in many of the areas that have been, you know, in the areas that have been consumed under GST, but nevertheless, state revenue and state finances remain important. So there is always the concern of what will happen if the process does not work out to an equitable solution where the states feel that they've been addressed. And how will that play out within the areas that states do continue to remain sovereign over taxation, such as petroleum and other areas? What will happen? So there can be some fallout in the marketplace as a result of a solution that does not seem equitable. So trust is foundational.
Sure. Trust is foundation of cooperative federalism, for sure.
Can I just come in for a minute?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
See, the spirit of sort of cooperation has to be built with a lot of sort of effort, and then it works. One of the small sort of agreement amongst the state, which has not been largely noted, was the sort of centralized collection of the stamp duty on shares and debentures, the securities, right? This we could do in 2018-19, again, when Mr. Jaitley was there, building on the trust with the states. Mr. Bhutani would know it, that it was such a bad state of affair. All these states used to levy stamp duty on share sale or something in manners which was so diverse, so disruptive and problematic. And they have now agreed that only the NSE or BSE collects in a very unobtrusive manner, and every stamp duty collected is shared with the states on the basis of the purchaser's residence. It was a very large system, but this is working very well now. Believe me, what Mr. Bhutani was referring to, the remaining agenda or the important agenda, whether it's land reforms or privatization of the public sector entities or labor reforms, none of them will work unless there is a complete sort of trust agreement and confidence between the center and the states, right? And powers, people in power change, nothing remains permanent. Today, 21 states have agreed to both. If there is a regime change, whenever it happens, these states might be at the receiving end. So we have to have a larger sort of approach. States are part of the union. At some point in time, one of the finance ministers said that the central budget today is the budget of states, because that is what either you have transfers or you have the centrally sponsored schemes or you have other schemes. Practically every expenditure takes place in states, except some defense and other kind of things. So it's very important to build that relationship and take Indian reform agenda on taxation as well as other reforms forward. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So what I'm hearing is there is a need for more political will and more political investment in nurturing this center-state relationship. Okay, so now I will open the floor to questions from the participants. We already have a few interesting ones. We'll take as many as we can handle in our time limit. So the first one comes from Upendra Bhagal. He asks, whether the current dispute over GST may lead to collapse of financial system and severe friction in center-state relations, which may lead to social problems as the states have to run most of the programs. Center and state need to work together to come over the present crisis. Many states don't have any funds and don't have any avenue to raise them. Well, most of this we have discussed, but you know, the essence is, will the current dispute lead to collapse of the financial system?
See, I don't think there is any way to walk out of the GST, but it's not an impossibility, right? If some state forced, let us say, for example, the center did not agree to sort of take loan and give, or what it was earlier saying that a lot of GST loss factor commitment, it's COVID and other things, and therefore the states. Now, if you drive these states to the wall, literally, there may be some reaction. I don't think it will happen. I don't wish it happens. But if a state decides to sort of walk out of it and say that, no, we revisit the 2016 GST agreement and we go back to that, it will be disruptive for them. So it's a theoretical possibility only, not a real one, but the damage is more in sort of creating rifts and conditions which make something like this to be even thought about or considered. Thank you.
So thank you.
You know, Nilima, can I?
Yes,
can I respond to that?
Yes.
I think Garg sir is exactly right. Whether it's something that can actually happen, the reputational risk that it creates in industry, I think, is tremendous. The notion that the framework's elements within the first 3 or 4 years of its implementation could be fundamentally changed, I think, is a very concerning prospect for industry. But it also can have implications not only for the domestic space, but the international space. Even as India tries to become a very competitive and attractive investment destination, the stable and structured tax environment, which can have bumps and hiccups and moles that need to be resolved and coughs and colds that need to be addressed, even that they can be serious ones. But from the international investors community, perspective, the notion that such a fundamental framework could be at risk of being reversed changes the competitiveness that India then has in the global marketplace from investors who are looking to either expand current investment through operations or to look at India for the first time as a new marketplace to enter. That stability and certainty is fundamental. And I think Mr. Bhutani, who works with, you know, the leading global companies in the world, you know, I think can share his perspective on the extent to which that certainty influences investment decisions. So whether it's a reality or not, there's some real risk, reputational risk that can happen.
Sure. Mukesh?
I think in my view, the biggest casualty here is the GST reforms, which is where Nilima's point comes about how the global community will look towards India. So it's one thing to say that this is a purely domestic issue and it will get sorted out. I mean, I consider this is a simple left pocket, right pocket syndrome. It really doesn't matter where it comes from. So even if you look at both the options that are available today, what is the difference in two options? The second options where states are seeking the entire compensation, including compensation, which the center feels is as a result of the act of God, the debate over there is who is going to bear the interest burden for that. I think the fact that neither the center nor the state has either put this to vote, which I think the vote will go in favor of the center, or walked out of the negotiation table gives me that hope that this will be sorted out. But I think the anxiety and the stress factors that it creates for external observers, you know, people like yourself sitting in Washington, D.C., and people that consult with you, I think that, in my view, becomes a casualty. Let's look at it this way. If I look at it very dispassionately, the center state compensation payment was a pre-COVID issue. It was already there. And I think it was there when Mr. Garg was at the helm of affairs in North Block. But at that point in time, this level of stress was not as accentuated as you see today, number one. Number two, now the writing was always on the wall that the government will have to extend the five-year compensation cess period. Now, who suffers as a result of that? Let me give you an example of one industry, the auto industry. 28% plus cess. I think it's pretty damaging for that industry, not just from the point of view of the growth of that industry, but even from the point of view of the consumer, the retail credit. I mean, okay, it's one thing to say that in 2017, the designers felt that if we have to create a kitty for compensation cess, we should put the non-merit goods and the luxury goods and the sin goods in the basket of 28% plus cess. And automobile unfortunately fell in that category because it's a major revenue earner. Even before we got onto the COVID crisis, an industry that was growing on a quarter-on-quarter basis for 27 years suffered. And it's a double blow for the industry today. So that industry is craving today, but the center's hands are also tied. You know, we should have looked at the 28% rate for the automobile industry much later. So now you have a situation where the supply constraints, demand constraints, and you have an elongated compensation cess period beyond 5 years. And eventually the casualty is the larger GST reforms that was supposed to be considered as one of the reforms that's going to put India back on the growth track.
Thanks, Mukesh. I have another interesting question from one of our participants. Besides conducting open market operation, is there another role that the RBI can play? Is it possible that the RBI monetizes state deficits, so to say? Why did the government want states to borrow from the RBI versus the central government borrowing from the open market on behalf of the states? We have 2 more minutes to answer this question.
See, the RBI has not been buying the state bonds until now. Only this week, the first time the RBI has bought the state bonds. The RBI was not even sort of allowing them for the repurchase operations, right? So it's a big move which has been taken, getting the state bonds on it. But it's I think advisable at this moment to go for the market borrowing by the central government because liquidity conditions are all right. And therefore, that course which is being adopted by the central government seems to be all right, that you borrow and give it to the states in the absence of the decision to give it as a grant.
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay, one more question. So this is on the recent CAG's report. So CAG highlighted that GST compensation cess was maintained in the consolidated fund of India and not public account. Aren't CESS proceeds to be ordinarily maintained in Consolidated Fund of India? Why are some CESSs maintained in the public account instead?
See, for the GST compensation CESS, there is a clear arrangement in the Act, GST Compensation Act, that the revenue which is collected in the form of CESS will be transferred to the GST fund in the public account, right? So every tax revenue has to come first in the consolidated fund. That is fine. That is the normal arrangement. But at the end of the financial year, whatever is undisbursed, you transfer it to the CESS fund in the public account. In 2017-18, it was done. So this was in line. But 2018-19, first time there was some bit of trickery which was done, that the transfer for 18-19 surplus was not made to the GST fund in the public account. Rather, the money transferred for 17-18 was also withdrawn into the consolidated. Yes. So that was not in line with the Act and the fair relationship, but so be it.
Mukesh, would you want to chip in? Did his screen just froze? Okay, let me move to the next question. Sitting on a forex reserve of more than $500 billion, can't the central bank sell a part of it to fund this deficit? Sir?
No, I couldn't listen to the question.
Oh, sorry. So sitting on a forex reserve of more than $500 billion, can't the central bank sell a part of it to fund this deficit?
No, no, that's a very different thing. Foreign reserves, if you sell, that is nobody's income. It becomes, if you sell, it will increase the currency supply, the money supply in the economy. It's nobody's income. It's not Government of India's reserve, right? And that solution doesn't work.
Yeah, sure. Mukesh, you wanted to add any point on the CAG's question?
No, I think that this is, I mean, if the question is more generally of, for all forms of CESSs, then that's a one part of it. But I think if it is in relation to the GST compensation CESS, I think Mr. Garg answered that question, that this is an action that we had only for one of the years. But I think the CAG comment, as I understood when I read the CAG report, was not necessarily on the GST compensation. It was in general about the CESS, because under the constitutional framework, the CESS which goes to the Consolidated Fund of India has to be necessarily expended for the purpose for which it was collected. And if that does not happen, then and the center cannot you know, put it into the central scheme allocated to the central schemes. I think that is the larger debate, which has been a debate in the past as well, not necessarily in relation to the compensation CESS.
Correct.
Sure. Okay, so we are coming to the, you know, nearing the top of the hour. And, you know, just to wrap this up, let me ask you all three a question, which is about, which is a little more, you know, forward looking. What would be your half crazy prediction on the center-state relationship in the next 1 or 2 years?
I see tensions building up. And that's not a fair thing to happen. It's not in the interest of the country. The best thing would be that if there is a course correction and the center adopts a more conciliatory and more cooperative, I think that would be in the interest of the country, but I don't see that sort of happening at this moment.
Yeah. Mukesh?
Well, as lawyers, we are taught two things. There are two parties to a dispute. One is a party that loses, and second is a party that gets bruised, not wins. So I think it could be anybody's guess who would lose and who would get bruised in this process. I agree with you that the level of stress is uncalled for, because we should remember that for economic growth, state participation is equally important. Whether the state participation comes through changes in important reforms in important subjects such as environment, labor, land, or it comes by way of states actually making productive use of the money that it gets from the center. So it's no longer the debate as to which state is in power and whether the state government that is in power, is it in power in the center or not. I think it has to work the spirit of cooperative federalism rather than in theory, which is what the constitutional framework seems to be rendered at this point in time.
Sure. Neelima?
I think Farag Sir and Kesh have said that very well. I think I will stick to my knitting and talk about the impact that we'll ultimately have. I see this as an inflection point framework overall in business, in that how they handle this will have long-term implications. And if the tensions continue to deepen, if they continue to start having spillover into how the states conduct their own taxes and revenue collection in the areas, I think that has the potential to fundamentally change the way India is seen in reaching its goal for economic growth. And the worst case scenario is not just the reversal of GST, but the lengthy court battles, changes in states, and creating a differentiation that companies then change their investment. And I think that will have much deeper and longer. So how the center and the state, I would be less reluctant to answer on what that relationship will be, but the urgency with which industry sees the need for there to be cohesiveness, I think, is fundamental, and they're going to watch for it.
This has been such a rich discussion. What I'm hearing is more political investment in this center-state relationship. State cooperation is essential. You lose sight of states, you lose sight of India. So yes, in the future of cooperative federalism, we remain hopeful. I cannot thank you enough for your openness and your very rich insights. Thank you so much. It has been an absolute pleasure. Thank you.